Welcome to my new video series.
Video number one. Learn what makes a painting great. Composition. All beauty is the result of fine proportions. Greeks were the first to invent and to use the mathematical proportion, linear perspective, and the concept of divine proportion and scale in art and architecture. Because of a conversion to Christianity, these postulates were abandoned in the Middle Age Europe, to reappear in the Italian Renaissance art several centuries later. Man is the measure of all things, becomes the mantra of the Renaissance artists as they explore the concept of rational thought by creating art that's three-dimensional, visually balanced, mathematically proportioned, and color unified. Composition becomes central to the creation of representational art. In this diagram, you see the fundamental principle of geometric division of space, or the divine proportion. A symbol of unity, the circle holds a pentagon inside with the five-pointed star of Pythagoras drawn inside it. Renaissance artists used this model to place their figures in a visually pleasing composition. Source: rhythmic forms in art. The School of Athens. This painting represents the exaltation of rational thought. The artist paints his contemporaries as models to represent ancient Greek philosophers, such as Plato and Aristotle, standing right in the middle of the composition. We see Leonardo as Plato, Bramante as Euclid, Raphael as Apelles, and Michelangelo as Heraclitus. Raphael incorporates the architecture of the room by creating a balanced composition that proportionally relates to the interior. The fresco has five circles. The height of figures and their placement corresponds to the mathematical divisions seen in the picture. Besides using pentagons, artists create symmetrical and asymmetrical balance with triangular compositions, the golden section rule, and several other devices that I'm going to show you here. In this painting, while the iconography is standard, the unusual part is its perfect linear perspective. It marks Masaccio as the first Renaissance painter who achieved visual realism of the figures receding in space naturally with correct foreshortening. In this artwork, the curving S shape creates an equal movement and balance of shapes on both sides of the painting by Michelangelo. This painting, done by Caravaggio, features the S shape design as well. We can see examples of triangular compositions in religious art, where a cross divides the space in half or is placed at a diagonal. In this painting by Rogier van der Weyden, the artist arranges the figures in a way that mimic the shape of the cross. The diagonal of Christ repeats itself in Mary's shape. The triangular shape was a popular element to design a composition. It creates balance with a line falling from the apex of the pyramid, dividing the picture in half. Claude Lorraine consciously designed his paintings following the rules of thirds, or the golden section, which is widely used today by photographers and artists alike. The artist also framed his landscapes with trees placed on both sides of a painting to create a circular motion, so a viewer never leaves his picture. He was also a master, creating a complete balance between the light and the dark masses of trees, buildings, water, and sky. Jean van Eyck strikes an equal balance of shapes around the middle where we see the joined hands. Emotion. Emotion is the strongest reason for artists to create art and for people to look at it and to own it. Art is a visual expression of our soul. We respond to a painting or a sculpture instantly by using our feelings as opposed to logic, and that's what makes us human. Meaningful art helps us connect with our inner life. It confirms a record of our emotions dwelling within our memories. Art is not only a cultural and historical object, but also a remedy that speaks universal language. Artists have a vast emotional landscape to reach deep to convey a story in a meaningful way. It's the feeling that draws us into the picture. Because we all have a unique set of experiences, we respond to the art in different ways. Some paintings leave us untouched, while others haunt us with their beauty, melancholy, joy, or fear. Painting is a record of beauty in both the beautiful and the ugly. Because feelings can't be quantified in immediate dollars and cents, unlike a fancy gadget or an expensive watch, many don't see value in art, think it's useless, and try to cut funding for school art programs and art organizations. As a consumer-driven society, we are conditioned to ignore craftsmanship, uniqueness, and beauty produced in a singular product, because a cheaper version of artistic creation is all around us for free. On social media, TV, magazines, shop posters, book covers, pillow designs, and so on. We see art, but we don't really study it. Only the encounter with the original artwork has that immediate impact, raw emotion that heals us. Romantic movement. Romanticism grew as a rebellion against the static cold ideals of the Greco-Roman art, against religion and social order. Romantics were liberals who produced art that incited viewers with emotions, especially the fear and the power of wild, changing nature as the source of the sublime. Romantics channeled these ideals via painterly movement and color. They wanted to reflect on real life, not some distant ideals. Artists celebrated freedom of creativity that found its support from new patronage of successful business class. Spanish artist Goya creates horror scenes with monsters and owls, depicts his nightmares that set to criticize Spanish society as corrupt and demented. The artist was for the French Revolution and against the King of Spain, yet was very popular as a court painter for Charles IV. Later Goya shows highly emotional art, painting royalty as individuals with psychological insight into their personalities that lacked idealization on purpose. Swiss painter Henri Fuseli painted somewhat erotic, moody, and supernatural pictures of dramatic Shakespearean scenes and dreams that ignited fear. In his painting, the skill of drawing is given away in favor of emotions and imagination. He painted several variations of this painting. Another neo-baroque French painter, Géricault, explored human extremes and violent action in his art. He painted people in action with the exuberance and energy of baroque artists. We can divide representational art into two opposing groups. One is dominated by the compositional design and the other by the use of color. While thoughtful design stands for rational thought in art, beautiful play of light and color evokes strong feelings. Those of you who have tried oil painting know how hard it is to achieve color unity. It's not only the skill of color mixing, but also the artistic vision and sensitivity to the color. In masterpieces, we see hues that interact and support each other. The complexity of a color comes with deliberate color mixing, dragging or glazing of the paint, overlaying and letting one hue dominate and complement the rest. The tradition of color descends from Titian to Rubens, to Van Gogh and Picasso. Seurat developed his own scientific color system called pointillism that didn't get traction among artists, however. The Impressionists redefined the use of color, not painting with black in the shadows. Unlike the majority of artists who worked in the studio, the Impressionists painted outdoors, capturing the weather conditions at different times of the day. That's why you see numerous paintings done of the same subject but in various lighting conditions. We can look at Claude Monet, water lilies, and Edgar Degas, dancers, to understand how artists were interested in atmospheric and light perception of places and people, the impression, rather than the actual copying of details. The Impressionists revolved against the Academism and its annual salon painting competitions to organize their independent shows that exhibited unconventional colorful art. During the same time period, in Russia we see a rise of national landscape painting with artists like Shishkin and Kuinja, who depicted vast lushes and vivid landscapes of the countryside. Toulouse-Lautrec, Van Gogh and Gauguin become the post-impressionism artists who focus on the spiritual in painting, channeling it through color and symbols. Line is the most vital element in visual art. Contour lines describe form and the initial drawing design. Drawings exist as a personal records of artist's idea and thoughts, having unique handwriting, gesture, and energy. Line drawings can be very expressive if an artist varies shape, thickness, and composition of the line. Rembrandt's drawings capture everyday activities in sketchy but confident, almost childlike lines. Drawings of Michelangelo are beautiful studies of models, where the lines define the physical anatomy and monumentality of male figures frozen in action. Da Vinci drawings perfectly describe the subject with soft, gentle lines, reminiscent of the softness we see in his paintings. It's amazing to see how Anger describes figures in his hollow drawings of just contour lines with minimal shading. Japanese printmakers Hiroshige and Hokusai become the two masters of woodblock printing in the country. They exercised great influence onto the Impressionists with their approach to compositional design and the simplification of shapes. Hiroshige's artwork is very linear and creates simplified shapes and patterns with the lines of varied quality. The leading Art Nouveau designer and painter used geometric shapes, mosaics and diagonals to create beautiful lithographs of women as idyllic symbols. Czech artist gave birth to his unique style with his posters of a famed actress that made him prominent in French Art Nouveau. His use of definitive contour line is central to his illustrative style. Austrian artist Gustav Klimt employs lines, patterns and shapes to create a unique visual experience. His figures are made of patterns with contour and geometric lines defining form. As spectators, we often don't pay attention to the artistic use of negative space. Negative space is simply the background you see behind your subject. It often affects how we perceive what's in front of us by carefully controlling the tone, color, and shapes in the background space. Let's look at one of the Spanish realist artists who used the negative space to his advantage. Because the Spanish court and the Catholic Church employed foreign painters in the 16th century Spain, native artists were not popular among the two major patrons, the church and the state. and therefore they were able to develop their still life painting that was non-existent before the 1590s. A deeply religious man, he painstakingly arranged simple objects at a curve, juxtaposing bright objects against the dark tones, where a rich background reinforces the realism of foreground shapes. Similarly, Caravaggio used the dark background to bring his subjects forward. He defined and mastered chiaroscuro, the balance of light and dark, in his paintings. So much so that when a viewer stands in a dark interior of a church, he sees abstract patterns of light and shade. When the light is turned on, the entire painting changes to a story we see in a design. His mastery of color, negative space, and contrast play with our perception of reality. Texture, paint, and brushwork quality. Our eyes travel across canvas to notice the unusual texture and brushwork, or purposefully to see none. Strokes of paint can describe the textures and shapes of fabric, skin, and space. They can also generate an emotional response to the subject itself. The artistic ability to do it freely takes years of experimentation and practice, like we see in Sargent's painting. Sargent's art has spontaneous brushwork quality that's actually deliberate and skilled. He was masterful at hitting the right note in a single stroke, and when he was not, the artist wiped it off with a rag and did it again. His paint strokes have relaxed elegance and fluidity, not easy to achieve. Traditional methods involve several painting techniques. Here I'd like to mention the glazing techniques used by Enger and David, as well as the impasto method of painting perfected by Rembrandt. Glazing creates depth and sophistication of a color by using thin, transparent layers of paint. The impasto technique creates texture in thick, opaque strokes. These two seemingly opposing methods are often combined together in a single work of art, like we see in the Rembrandt's paintings that create the glow in his portraits. Jean van Eyck was a fundamental figure in Northern Europe, the first to perfect the oil painting technique. He had strong interest in optics and light effects to create painstakingly detailed realism. In this kind of art, you don't see any brushwork to convey realism. The artist uses lots of glazes to build up the color. Impasto comes from the Italian to put in paste. Impasto is applied thickly on a canvas or panel with a brush or a palette knife that raises the paint surface and makes the strokes visible. Impasto creates textures in clothes, jewelry, and skin that looks like a suggestion of the fabric or skin rather than a direct representation of it. Fine examples of artists using such techniques are Rembrandt, Velázquez, Titian, and Goya.
I hope you enjoyed watching my video where you discovered how story, composition, emotion, and texture all contribute to our perception of the masterpieces. It's the visual harmony and the beautiful that sparks emotion in us. But a great painting has more than just a good composition or a vibrant color. Great painting owns a transformative, spiritual truth that transcends time and space and allows you to understand yourself and therefore the world around you. Stay tuned for my next video in the series that focuses on contemporary painting. Meanwhile, go to my website veronicasart.com, subscribe to my art notes, and receive a free gift. Thanks for watching, guys. Bye-bye.